Hey guys! If you're a visual learner and this is how you're studying for antibiotics, stop right now. Today, we're going over everything there is to know about a popular class of antibiotics called cephalosporins. Make sure you stick around to the end as we review some mnemonics and memorization tips to help you retain the information for exams. So if you're ready, let's color and learn. Cephalosporins are one of the biggest classes of antibiotics with many different generations. It is one that a lot of people struggle with, but today we're going to break it down in a fun and easy way that works. When you think of cephalosporins, use the visual anchor cephalopod to help you remember the important points in this class. On exams, you may be asked which cephalosporin is a first generation versus a third generation. Unfortunately, there isn't a straightforward way to memorize this, but no worries, I've got you. Use these visuals and mnemonics to help you commit this to memory. Let's start with the first generation. First generation cephalosporins all start with a cepha sound, such as cephazolin, cephalexin, and cephadroxyl. The only exception to this is cephalochlor, which is the second generation cephalosporin. Color in this ear on the first tentacle to help you remember the first generation cephalosporins have beginning sounds like cepha and write those in. For second generation cephalosporins, we have to get a little creative. Remember this mnemonic, two furry foxes tan faces like pros. Let's go over that again. Two stands for second generation, furry is for cephoroxime, foxes stands for cefoxitin, tan is for cephatatin, faces is for cephachlor, and pros is for ceprazil. Let's go over that again a couple times in our heads as we color in this visual with the two furry foxes with tan faces on the second tentacle for second generation. For third generations, again, it's a pretty big class, so we have to get creative again. Imagine this mnemonic in your head. Three po' docs were fixing dinner and got tased for not paying taxes. Let's go over it again. Three stands for third generation cephalosporins. Po' docs is for cephadoxime. Fixing is for cefixime. Dinner is for ceftonir. And tased is for ceftazidine. And finally, taxes is for cefotaxime. How are you guys doing? Stay with me as the last two generations are the easiest to remember. Fourth generations have the root pi in them, so imagine a pi on the fourth tentacle. The pi stands for cefepime. Fifth generations have the root word O in it, so think of an old person on the fifth tentacle. These drugs include ceftaroline and ceftolozane. Color in the old person to give your brain some time to memorize this. I highly recommend you take a couple of minutes to go over which drugs belong to which generation using this visual to allow that information to really sink in. If you need to pause this video and quiz yourself to see how much you can remember, go ahead and do it now. Alright, moving on. Another reason why it's so important for you to understand which cephalosporin belongs to which generation is the type of bacteria that each generation cover changes as you get higher in the generations. For example, first generation cephalosporins have good gram-positive coverage and weak gram-negative coverage. And since gram-positive organisms tend to stain purple on a gram stain, we want to color the first tentacle in purple to remind ourselves that the first generations have good gram-positive coverage. Going from first to third generation, the coverage of gram-negative bacteria increases while coverage of gram-positive bacteria decreases. And since gram-negative bacteria stains a pinkish red on a gram stain, let's color the second and third tentacle in a mixture of purple and red to remind ourselves that second and third generation start to have more gram-negative coverage. The fourth and fifth generation are unique because their coverage is broader, with ceftazidime, cefepime, and ceftolozane covering Pseudomonas, while ceftaroline is the only cephalosporin that covers MRSA. This class of antibiotics is used to treat a variety of bacterial infections, including pneumonia, cellulitis, and urinary tract infections. The choice of cephalosporin antibiotic to use depends on what we are treating and what bacteria is commonly associated with that infection. This takes time and practice, so don't get overwhelmed trying to memorize everything now, and instead understand the general idea of what it covers by generations as well as the unique ones that cover Pseudomonas and MRSA. Some precautions and contraindications to keep in mind. You want to review the patient's allergies prior to prescribing cephalosporin antibiotics, as anaphylaxis or severe allergies can occur. Note that cross-reactivity with penicillin allergic patients is low, less than 2%, but the risk is higher when prescribing first or second generation cephalosporins. You want to be cautious in patients with severe renal dysfunction, as renal dose adjustments are required. However, the only cephalosporin that doesn't require renal adjustments is ceftriaxone. The brand name for ceftriaxone is Rocephin. So think Rocephin sounds like rogue, so it is the only one that stands out not requiring renal adjustments. So how does this class work? Similar to penicillin, cephalosporins are also called beta-lactam antibiotics, as they have a four-member ring in their chemical structure that binds onto penicillin-binding proteins and inhibits bacterial wall synthesis. This leads to weak cell walls and bacterial cell death. Let's color in this mechanism of action, as the cephalosporin, aka cephalopod, is inhibiting penicillin-binding protein from cross-linking and inhibiting bacterial cell wall synthesis. Moving on to side effects. Cephalosporins have the same side effects as penicillins. Again, cephalosporins have the same side effects as penicillins, with the majority of them being GI-related or allergic reactions. Think back to the same mnemonic we used to memorize penicillin side effects. The mnemonic nasty diarrhea stands for, N is for nausea, so let's color in this N looking nauseous. A is for abdominal pain. S is for skin rash or seizures with high doses, especially in patients with renal impairment. I'm coloring this S as those shaking with seizures and itching all over. T is for throat closes to remind you of allergic reactions such as anaphylaxis. And D is for diarrhea, as taking antibiotics can disrupt the normal GI flora and lead to the side effect of diarrhea. Last, let's review some quick clinical pearls/counseling points. As with any antibiotic, you want to educate your patients to complete the full course of therapy, even if symptoms resolve. If a patient is prescribed a suspension, counsel them to shake the suspension to ensure all the drug is dispersed evenly in the solution prior to administration. Take with or without food, but generally you can counsel your patients to take it with food if upset stomach occurs. Alright guys, that's it for today. If you found this helpful, click that subscribe button for more. Let me know if you have questions in the comments. I will be happy to answer them. And remember to never stop having fun while you learn. If you're interested in getting more information from our Top 200 Drugs Made Easy coloring book, I'll leave a link to the product below in the description, and I'll see you in the next video.